and welcome to Family Matters. I love you. Let's have a baby. This is a phrase a partner may express, or at least think, in a moment of sexual intimacy. Interestingly enough, this is not uniquely human. Other animals also establish a bond through the producing of offspring. From the evolutionary perspective, monogamy is the basis for biparental care. That is, the relationship between mother and father determines how they go about parenting. For humans, it means that the quality of parenting has to do with the quality of the couple's relationship. Some would argue that being a mother or a father is a two-person thing, mother-child, father-child. But instead, my guest would argue it's a three-person system. Peg Donley has been studying, teaching, publishing and speaking about Bowen theory, and has an interest in monogamy, sex, and parenting. She's a licensed social worker in private practice in Kansas City. She's co-director of the Bowen Family Systems Clinical Seminars, also in Kansas City. She was on the faculty in the Marriage and Family Therapy Training Program in the Manningham Foundation for 12 years, and she has been involved with the Bowen Center in Washington, D.C. since 1985. Peg, welcome to Family Matters.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
So tell me, how did you get interested in this topic of monogamy, sex, parenting?
Well, I would say that probably 60 to 70% of the people that I see clinically present with a marital problem primarily. So I would see many, many, many people that would come in with marital problems, and most of these people, probably 95% of them, have children. So I began to observe certain patterns repeatedly. And they were patterns such as the males would tend to focus on the females, and the females would talk about their children. And I began to look at this more and more, and I thought, wow, you know, maybe there is a neurobiology to this process. Maybe this is not really just uniquely human. So I have a really strong interest and a strong background in science. So I went and started doing the research about 10 years ago, and just combed through and really began to look at what processes exist in other monogamous mammals.
So you started studying other species that other than human and saw that they were guided, or they were moved by a system in their biology that would account for their behavior, something like that?
Yes, in other words, I was so excited because I kept seeing in the neurobiology literature all this information that seems so similar with, say, prairie voles. Prairie voles are a monogamous rodent, but they are very monogamous. They have biparental care and they live in family units. And Sue Carter in particular has done a great deal of research in this area, and she would talk about all the processes that go on in these rodents that is actually very similar to what I see in my office.
For example,
I was intrigued.
For example, what's the behavior of these rodents?
The thing I was most interested in is looking at how much the male and female influence each other and how that influence impacts the biparental care. Biparental care simply means that both the male and the female are taking care of the young. This is fairly rare in mammals. This only happens in about 5% of mammals. But prairie voles happen to be a particular species that has been studied a lot, so it's a lot of research on them. But you would see things like what would happen when the male would be removed from these biparental monogamous units. What would happen to the offspring? And what you would see with the offspring is that they did not do as well when they were raised only by the mother. Or if you stressed the mother, what would you see would be the outcome with the offspring? But what there's this dance that's always going on between the male and female. And particularly you would see this when I got interested in Charles Snowden's research in looking at monogamy in non-human primates, such as tamarins. And he looked at how the pair bond in non-human primates, this particular species, has everything in the world to do with the involvement of the father, for example, how involved the father is.
Why don't you go and tell us a couple of these research in more detail so I can have a sense of exactly what these researchers observed and what can we learn about how this is not about mother-father, I mean mother-child, father-child, but about
right.
The threesome.
Okay, well, if you look, for example, at Charles Snowden's research in particular, and I'm going to use that because it has to do with the primate, which is closer. People can relate to that a little bit more than prairie voles, which are actually just rodents. What you see with tamarins, for example, is that the male is putting a lot of energy into mating effort with the female. And he does this through taking care of the offspring. So the more he carries the offspring, the more likely he is to have mating opportunities with the woman, with the female. Mm-hmm. So that's very interesting. So, you know,
how does the female know?
The female observes that the father of the little tamarin, uh-huh. that the father is carrying him, and she likes that, and so she mates with him more often.
Wow.
So he talked about actually in his research, and he has lots and lots of research on this, about how the pair bond between the male and female tamarin actually impacts how much the father is involved in the care of the young.
What would happen if the female doesn't allow that contact and that sexual contact with it? Would the father lose interest in the offspring?
I guess I would ask that a different way. Again, these are not humans, so right. We don't know what goes on in the head of a tamarin, right? What you can see is that when females are upset, or you see this in humans, for example, when they've done research on this, which is really interesting. So when a female is watching a male, and she has pictures of a male who's taking care of children, she is literally more attracted to that man. If she sees pictures of a male who is ignoring a baby that's screaming, she finds that male unattractive. Men do not do this in reverse.
Hmm.
If you show a woman who is taking care of a baby versus one that's ignoring a cry, there's no difference in how he rates attractiveness.
Them.
Yes.
So for, at least in the human species, for women, a man that takes care of a baby is more attractive than a man that ignores the baby.
It's not actually just in humans. There's also research that was done, I believe, in rhesus macaque monkeys, where they would take the female mother and they would put her behind either a glass where she could see but the male couldn't see her, mm-hmm. or a partition where she couldn't see the male, or both of them could see each other. I hope I explained that correctly. But anyway, the same thing was found that was found in human males and females, and that is that if she observed that how the male treated the infant, if he knew that the female was looking, he treated that infant better than he did if he thought that the mother was not looking. You with me? And so how she responded to him had to do precisely with his care of the infant or lack of care of the infant.
This information that you have learned from the research, that is objective. There's no values
right.
here, what is right or what is wrong, because I mean, monkeys don't know.
Right.
They don't know.
Right, right.
There's not a moral code behind any of these. It's
right.
It's automatic. It's sort of wired. And we humans also have a piece of that. We might then add the moral code or the value piece, but underneath that is just our biology and how we're wired as an animal species. Knowing that, how does that help you to understand the couples that you have in your office worried about how the father treats Johnny?
It has everything to do with what I do clinically. First of all, remember that the cortex evolved much later in the course of evolution than did these basic emotionally driven processes that go on. And many of these processes are conserved, by the way, that were conserved in human behavior that exist in other species. And I find this to be particularly true in monogamy in mammals. But in terms of what I do clinically, what happens, I think, and this actually gets into another discussion around neuropeptides and how neuropeptides affect social behavior in the human, so that, males, for example, would have more receptors in the brain of a neuropeptide called vasopressin. Females have more receptors in the brain for a neuropeptide called oxytocin. Now, most people know that oxytocin is what happens when you give birth and you breastfeed your children and you are so attached. This is all driven largely, not completely, but largely through oxytocin and how it operates in the brain. Females have more receptors for oxytocin than do males. Males have something that's very similar, akin to it, but different. It's vasopressin. This is going to be relevant in a minute here. So what happens a lot of times in the marriages that I see is that you hear these frequent repetitive complaints. Things like the woman complains that he's not helping her enough, she has to do all the work, all he wants is sex, and he doesn't help out with the children, he's not engaged enough with the children. Fathers, on the other hand, have consistent things that I hear all the time. They say, all she cares about is the kids. Nothing I do is right. Everything I do is wrong. I've stopped trying. She's not interested in sex anymore. I'm not trying anymore. He becomes more and more angry and resentful. Now, what does that do to her? Of course, she's not interested in that. She backs away more. He becomes more angry and vigilant and vigilant. She backs off more, and then they see Peg Donley. That's what happens. And they come in with the problem of, we have a problem with communication. No, not really. They could communicate fine when they fell in love. The problem is kind of gridlock, blame, blame, blame. But these patterns are very similar between males and females in how they operate.
If it's based in biology, there's always the argument that, well, what can I do? Mm-hmm. This is my body, or this is my, you know, it's hardwired. What can I do? I just can't do more or can't do different. What do you say on
that? One of the great things I believe about Bowen Family Systems Theory is that it allows for this very important thing called variation. So although I would argue that all of these processes do operate in males and females differently, the degree to which they operate has to do with their extended family, has to do with how they manage themselves in their extended family, how sensitive they are to the other. And so you see tremendous variation. So one guy, for example, the marriage starts to, they start having terrible intense conflict at the moment that she gets pregnant. Because why? She begins to focus more on having the baby. All of her resources start to go in, and he feels left out. And he gets more and more angry. That does not bring her closer to him. And this is what one of the things that I try to help people see is that your anger, particularly males towards females, does not promote affection and does not promote receptivity for women, particularly around sex. In fact, it does the opposite. And so it becomes this mindless process. I think that what I do in therapy is that I help people see, stand back and see a bigger picture. There are ways that this operates. And it isn't so personal that you think, you know, your husband's just feeling left out, or your wife is just feeling like she's overwhelmed, and you're nowhere to be found. So, mm-hmm.
And does knowing that help anyone change their behavior, or is it too ingrained that it's just what we do?
I think it really can help a lot of people to be able to get that level of objectivity on it, to understand what goes on in the brain, how does this work, how does the triangle work. So by triangle I mean she gets aligned with the children, he feels excluded. And the more angry he gets about her over-involvement, the more intense the process becomes. The more angry she gets about his not being involved, the more intense the process becomes. If people can stand back and see that, they can get out of a little bit better. They're able to get out of, it's your fault that this is happening. And of course, men and women both do this in marriages. Mm-hmm. Blame, blame, blame. And it's really hard to be able to get objective enough to see what is their part, how can they get a little bit more objective about how this works?
So something that strikes me as interesting is that it is not the female focusing on the male and the male and the female, but it's like, the man and the woman, or the male and the female and the offspring. And then the offspring, where does that go?
Well, let me back up a little bit. The reason I sort of presented it that way, again, this has got to do with neurobiology. So maternal circuits are older from an evolutionary point of view than is paternal care. So maternal circuits are deeply embedded in females.
What do you mean older? Can you clarify that?
From an evolutionary point of view, they came on the scene much earlier than did paternal care. Paternal care did not evolve in the same way. And again, that's a very complex topic that I won't go into right now. But paternal care evolved differently than maternal care. So you can see maternal care in all mammals, actually. You don't see paternal care in all mammals at all. You see paternal care, particularly active paternal care, only in mammals that have monogamy. So when you see, though, paternal care in non-monogamous animals, such as, say, baboons, what you do see is that baboons are much more likely to provide care to offspring and the young if they are connected to the female and having sex with her.
So not this, if they are the parent
no,
of that
right,
offspring.
Right. This is actually a really important distinction because paternal genetic relatedness does not predict paternal behavior in non-human primates and non-human mammals.
Something like they're not there for the offspring, but for the mother of the offspring?
They're there basically because they're invested in the female. And nowhere do you see this more often than in divorced families. If I may say a few things about that.
Yeah, go ahead.
Because it's really interesting. What you see oftentimes, not always, but after a divorce, and if a man, so Joe and Sally get divorced, it's a bad divorce, Joe marries Susie Q, he is much more likely to not have much of a relationship with his biological children. This is not true with women. Divorce and widowhood, particularly widowhood, if men are widowed, and this has all been researched, they have a much less likelihood of having ongoing contact with their children. It's not nearly as frequent as it is if the father died and the mother's still living. So that divorce and widowhood has very little effect on maternal in terms of how often the involvement that the mother has with her children. But divorce and widowhood has a significant effect on males. Now, how is this useful? So the other day I saw a woman who came in. She was 30 years old. Her parents have been divorced since she was 10. She has basically no relationship with her father. And she's enraged about this. How could he do this? And he got married and had more children with someone else, and he's very involved with those kids. She has no contact. And so she is very upset about the fact that her father didn't love her. Now, I would argue something very differently. I understand that how she could feel that way. But the reality is that the father's relationship with her was really mediated by the mother. So if the father was unwilling, unable to have a relationship with her mother, he was not going to have a relationship with her. Now again, variation. Some men do this much better than other men. But I see this all the time. It was helpful for her to understand that this is oftentimes the way males behave around in their relationships with females, which are primary.
Let me go back to a train of thought that you were having and then I caught you off about the neuropeptides that are involved. And you said that parental care evolved later in the...
Paternal
care evolved later. And then you were going to say how this is important.
The reason why that's important to know that is that there is reason to believe that paternal care often involves the relationship with the female. So that if males are connected to females, they are more likely to demonstrate paternal care. Again, this is not only in the human research, this is also in the research in non-human monogamous mammals.
But the mother doesn't have to have the father in order to have that connection with the child, because
that's right.
This is more, it's already there. Something.
Again, yeah. Now this is deep. This is very deep. This is where you have to say, well, you know, do humans come out of their families, how they were raised, how their grandparents raised their parents, all of this has a tremendous effect on the details of how this gets manifested in families. But some of the basic processes that are underneath all of this, that paternal care, you just see a lot more variation in paternal care in humans, for example, than you do in maternal care in humans. much more likely that men will be less involved with their children if they get divorced or they're widowed than women, for example.
Does that
make sense?
Yes. Does that happen in other ways of organization, social organizations? Meaning that being, I think I heard you saying before in another talk, that regardless of the culture, men that are spending time with a woman, the mother of the child, are more involved in parenting than those who don't. Can you explain?
There's actually a lot of research about third world countries. There was one researcher that I'm afraid I can't remember his name, but he, in this fairly old research, where he looked at like 100 societies across the world, and looked at what's the major predictor of paternal care. The major predictor of paternal care across all cultures is a father's relationship with the woman, with the mother.
How do you measure that relationship? Or
they measure it through things like the amount of contact he has, the amount of interactions he has, all of that kind of stuff. This is all science research, so there's very specific ways of how this is measured. Mm-hmm. So that males who sleep with their wives, eat with their wives, in Africa, for example, there was a number of studies that were done in Africa about this, that males who sleep with their wives and eat dinner with their wives and are relating to their wives throughout the day, those males are much more paternal than males that are not doing that with their wives.
So it's about the woman.
It's about the relationship.
Okay.
It's about the relationship. Again, it goes back sort of to what Charles Snowden had noticed, which is that if the pair bond is going well, the male does a much better job of taking care of the offspring.
Tell me if this is simplifying what you're saying. If I want my husband to be a better father, I should work on the relationship with him and not force him
yes.
to be a better father.
Thank you. That's great. That's exactly right.
Oh, dear.
So what women get really bogged down with is they get mad that their husband's not more involved with the kids, and they criticize him. You're not doing enough with Johnny. Totally not going to work. What's going to work is if she moves in a more positive way towards him, maybe she even has sex with him, that would make him much more likely to be involved with the children. And I need to be very careful in saying how
right.
I said that. I don't want to imply in any way that women should prostitute themselves in their marriage, for heaven's sakes. I'm just saying that in marriages that are cooperative, so you scratch my back, I scratch yours, those marriages do very well with parenting. Much better than, you know, people get angry at each other because they're not doing what the other one wants them to do vis-a-vis the kids. And oftentimes this is mothers being mad that the fathers are not more involved with the children.
I think that makes it very clear that parenting is not a one-to-one, but it's a threesome.
It's a threesome. And I would also say that Bowen Family Systems Theory has hypothesized this triangle, primary triangle, as part of the emotional unit. But I've always thought, not always, but until recently thought, so how do we know that? I mean, how do you know that's just not something you pull out of the air, that idea? And I'm telling you, it's in neuroscience, and the research is all there, and looking at other monogamous species. It's all there, how the interactions between the male and female impact how the males are taking care of the offspring. But let me add one more thing if I have a minute to do that. Do I? Okay. Because in marriages, for example, where there is not a father, all things being equal, those kids don't do as well. So if you look at the sociobiological research on this, women who raise their children as single parents, their kids don't do as well educationally, they don't do as well in the job market, they have much poorer outcomes than children that are raised by both parents, unless the grandparents are involved. That's a very important mediating factor. But, you know, I do think that women, so obviously having a male there, a good male, that you can trust, that is helping, that you two are cooperating, has a significant impact on women's ability to mother too.
Mm-hmm. And then there's also these research that says that it's better to have a separated couple than a couple with conflict. Can you just clarify that so it
yes.
doesn't sound like it's a...
Thank you.
We're not understanding.
A really bad predictor for children really is conflict, intense conflict in the marriage. And you're right. So intense conflict, whether people are divorced or stay together, is not good for kids. Now, I suspect that that's a pretty simplistic view. I think that people who are looking at Bowen family systems theory, certainly I am looking at this, which is, it's a lot more than just conflict. But conflict is a thing that's easily researchable. Mm-hmm. So we know that conflict has a bad outcome for children, conflict in marriages. So, you know, I don't think that staying together and having a horribly conflictual marriage is necessarily a good thing at all. You might do better off getting divorced and having your mother help, you know, recruiting other people involved in helping you raise your children.
Right. Well, I think it's very clear as we close up this segment that good parenting has to do not only with the relationship with the child, but the relationship in the couple. And the quality of that relationship is going to affect the way mother and father do their job.
Right.
At another time, I would be interested in hearing now what's the response of the child as well, because he's not just an actor.
That's another whole talk. Yes, you're right.
Give me a glimpse of what would that be, because it's.
Mm-hmm. I think that again. Only child versus one of four children, you know, you see lots of variation. Children get born into a certain position in a family. Though if there are four kids in a family, on all likelihood, one will be more sensitive. You'll see one that is the most sensitive to what's going on in the parents, and one that's the least sensitive, and sort of getting on with his or her life pretty well. So you see a lot of variation, but when there is intense conflict in a marriage, those kids are very, very acutely aware of it, and they're in it. They are not free of it completely, ever. And, you know, you might argue that, you know, people pick people in their own lives that to some degree perpetuate what they grew up in. I think that that's an argument that could be made.
Well, you have given me topics for like other three or four of these family matters. Thank you, Peg, for being here today.
You're welcome.
I'd like to remind you that the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family offers the community affordable psychotherapy in both English and Spanish. If you would like more information about our topic or the services at the Bowen Center, please visit the website at www.thebowencenter.org or send me an email at familymatters@thebowencenter.org. You can find us on Facebook or call 202-965-4400. Thank you for watching. And I invite you to join me again for another edition of Family Matters. I'm Dr. Mariana Martinez, and your family does matter.